This is Glambition Radio, episode number 233 with Kara Goldin, founder and CEO of Hint. Welcome to Glambition Radio. I am your host, Allie Brown. I'm an entrepreneur, mentor, investor, and mom of twins. I love thinking big, doing different, and exploring ideas that disrupt the status quo, especially when it comes to women, because we are rewriting the rules for leadership, business success, making money, and changing the world. And we're doing it with style. Let's go. How are you in this interesting month of October 2020, especially here in the States? On Instagram, please follow me there, by the way, Allie Brown Official. I recently posted a classic clip of Betty Davis saying her line, "Fasten your seatbelts, it's going to be a bumpy night." And that just kind of sums it up. If you agree with me, please come drop me a note. And I want to say thank you, by the way. All of you listening have been my sane against the machine. When I look outside of our tribe of women who think critically about things and are open to hearing different opinions, they may be like, you know what, I don't agree with that at all, but that was an interesting perspective and it got me clear about what I stand for. I mean, this is how we need to lead the way, because people are forgetting this. So those notes that you drop me, when you say like, I love this show and thank you for doing what you're doing, or even dropping a note saying, you know, I didn't agree with this, but thank you for doing what you do, or it means so much more than you realize. I think we need to do this for other people and their shows as well, but I'm asking for it selfishly for myself in this crazy month. So drop me a note on Instagram, at least under the Betty Davis video. You'll love that. So I'm so excited to bring you a guest today who is genuinely one of my favorite people in the world. Kara Goldin and I were blessed to meet in 2012. I think I was pregnant with my twins, but hadn't really been telling people yet. And we'll tell you about the story today, but she had just started a few years prior her company, Hint. And I love the water. If you know you should be drinking more water, or you already do and you're just a little tired of water, Hint is water infused with these beautiful fruit essences. And she was the pioneer of this category. There's people trying to knock it off, but they're using some suspicious ingredients. You want to buy Hint and you want to support this woman. So follow her, buy the water. They can ship it to your door. I get the boxed versions for my kids when they want a little something different, and they drink that. They took those to school last year. But I want to have her on the show again. She was on a few years ago. I want to have her on a show because she has a new book that's come out. It's called Undaunted. And man, it is everything I wanted to know about Kara and more. You know, we get to spend a little time together, but I don't typically grill her on her past. And it's so good. You've got to pick up a copy. And I'm also delighted to announce that Kara is going to be our special guest advisor at the official spring meeting of the Trust. And when I say special guest advisor, I mean, this isn't another inspirational keynote. These women who we bring in, who are typically the founders and CEOs of companies doing over $100 million a year, spend time with us. They speak, they answer questions, they talk with us. It's a totally different experience than you may have had at some other bigger networks. We're a tight group and we want real information. And so she's going to be joining us. So if you're interested in hearing more about what we have going on with the Trust for next year and some special events coming up, go to jointhetrust.org and see if it's a fit for what you want to create next year. And we'll be happy to talk with you if you're interested and would like more details. Okay, jointhetrust.org. Quick shout out to two of you who left some great reviews for us on Apple Podcasts. The first is Jenny Goncher from the U.S. I so encourage you to take the time for yourself to listen to Allie's Glambition Radio as curriculum and inspiration. Take notes. It is hands down my most personally critical listen as a businesswoman and mom. And Just What I Needed, 5 stars by Polar Dog 11. I just found Allie's podcast, and here she is with the always enlightening Dr. Christiane Northrup, whose books I've enjoyed for years. Keep up the great work. I look forward to listening to many more episodes. Thank you for taking the time to leave those reviews. It helps us grow. It helps other women learn more about these enlightening conversations. Now, let's get right to our special guest today, Kara Goldin. Kara, where are you right now?
I am in Marin County in my house, which actually I'm liking again. Like during this time, I took the time to gussy things up a little
bit. Gussy. I haven't heard that word in a long time.
I know, right? And it's my pad now. I'm digging it.
Yeah. So did the fires, I've lost track of the fire map. Like, did that come close to you guys or no?
Within 9 miles,
oh, wow.
The ones that sort of eased up a couple of weeks ago, it was on the coast by Point Reyes, kind of Stinson Beach. So that is about 9 miles from me. And we're thankfully separated by like a mountain range. So we weren't worried about it, but the smoke was really bad. And now Napa is burning. Mm. And I have many friends that have lost places up there and have been displaced. And, you know, it's really crazy. It's not clear to me, though, what is going on up there. Nobody seems to know exactly. I mean, people are definitely pointing to global warming. I'm not saying that global warming isn't happening by any stretch, but it's, I don't know, it just seems strange that they just started.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that to me just seems odd. And we haven't had any lightning or anything on this round for the last few weeks. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see exactly what comes out of it.
This is the year of not understanding anything happening, really.
Right? I know. Don't you? I know. I feel exactly the same way. And I feel, you know, stories every day where I feel fortunate, right? Like I feel sad for so many, but I also feel, you know, like fortunate that it isn't happening to me. And, you know, to some extent, you know, I have a beverage company, a water company that I'm able to sort of help and do what I can. We've been, you know, supporting a lot of first responders throughout all of COVID. And, you know, so I feel like I'm a little too aware of kind of what's going on and doing what I can, but I still feel like, you know, it's 2020 is a tough year for many and some more than others.
Yeah. Yeah. That's an understatement. I'm not even going to respond because then we'll go a whole different direction.
Yeah, exactly.
That's just too much. There's too much. I want to let's talk about you. I'm so excited to reconnect with you again. We've known each other now since I think 2012. I think I met you when I was pregnant, when I was in New York, right?
I think we met the year before. And then when I saw you the second time and I was so excited to see you, I think that that's when.
Maybe.
I think. Or maybe I didn't know you were pregnant.
I think I wasn't telling anyone yet. Yeah.
Yeah. That could have also been.
And still having a glass of wine, by the way, because I was in shock.
And, you were so funny.
But I was just so grateful to be able to meet you through the EY Winning Women. I want to give them a shout out. I've met so many amazing women through that program.
Right? I know. Amazing program. And learned so much from them.
Yeah. So you had just, I knew of you about the product. You'd been out, I think, for, you know, a few years by then at least. And then, you know, what happens often is like, you know, you and I will lose touch for a while, then we'll reconnect. And I'm like, oh, you're doing another 50 million and like another 50 million. The thing has just started to really snowball. Like it seems like the last several years, at least. Can you give everyone a snapshot of, you know, should we go back? You want to talk about your career before? Hint, let me know where you'd like to start.
Yeah. So, you know, I didn't start in the beverage industry. Let's say that. So let's start there. I actually grew up in media and the magazine industry. And then I worked at CNN and then ended up going into the internet world and worked for a little spin out of Apple that was doing online shopping. And then that parlayed into America Online and was there for the most amount of years prior to actually Hint, where I've been the founder and CEO now for 15 years. But basically, I was running at AOL their online shopping and e-commerce partnerships. And so it was almost like a mall, an online mall, and dealing with retailers. We had no idea what we were doing. I mean, there was no revenue targets in the beginning. It was basically like, this is just a dream. Let's see if we can make it happen.
When was this, to give people an idea?
1995 okay. to 2001, yeah. I was there.
Wow.
And so, yeah, so it was a crazy time. It was a wild ride. It was clearly, you know, the internet heyday. And I, in the midst of all this, and, you know, I was traveling like 300,000 miles a year. I knew the United pilots from San Francisco to DC and New York. And finally, somewhere in there, I was able to actually get pregnant and have a couple of kids. And I was on maternity leave with my second child in 2001 when I found out I was pregnant with my third child, which in 13 months, sort of like having twins, mm-hmm. Allie. And Allie has twins. And so I was you know, really trying to figure out not only what I could do back in San Francisco where I live, but also something that just had purpose for me. You know, 9/11 had a major impact on me. I had lived in New York and in many ways felt like I grew up in New York. And I think I just thought, like, if there's no tomorrow, am I actually doing what I want to be doing? And am I passionate about it? And while I had a great career at AOL and I really loved e-commerce, I felt like, you know, there were some things that were blocking me from actually growing, including technology and sort of what I thought would be great if it was ever figured out, you know, in terms of things that, you know, I knew how to describe them. I didn't know how to actually achieve them. And also just, again, going back to 9/11, I really felt like there was this, you know, kind of hole in my heart thinking like, if this is it, if there's no tomorrow, am I actually doing something that makes a difference? Mm. And so that was like, I thought maybe I should go into a nonprofit. And, you know, I somewhat joke, but somewhat seriously talk about, you know, how the internet kind of ruined me because it was on such a fast pace and we were always learning. Nobody felt like we had the roadmap. I mean, it was like, just talk to more people, have more meetings and, you know, see where we can go and see what we can do. And so it was always like, you know, can I actually do something versus somebody at some other company versus like feeling like, oh, I can't talk to that person because they're, you know, in a competitor or something. And so anyway, I'd sort of grown up in this kind of unique existence that I didn't even realize I was living in. Again, I was a young person just sort of doing what I was doing. And then ultimately, when I decided to take this time off, I was, you know, trying to look at different nonprofits. And part of my issue, Allie, was like, I actually like had a lot of interests. And so I thought, you know, I wasn't just like, okay, I need to just focus on the American Heart Association. For me, like that would have been easy. I felt like there were so many causes out there that I believed in breast cancer research. I believed in American Heart. So I was like this person that was like looking at all these different organizations. Also at this point, having three young kids. And I felt like even though I volunteered for some of these things and did some, you know, kind of research into doing some board work, it was like really slow and decisions were not being made as fast as I had seen in the internet.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Nonprofits. Oh my God. I can't imagine. I'd be just slow as molasses.
And I was going crazy, right? Trying to figure this out. So anyway, so that was for me, you know, this kind of epiphany. And then I started thinking, okay, maybe it's not that. Let me go and look a little further at, you know, some other things. And I hadn't really figured out what that thing was. But while I was doing it, I thought, okay, well, I've gained all this weight while I've been having kids and I've got terrible adult acne that came out of nowhere and I had no energy. And so I decided I'm going to start getting in shape and losing this weight and figuring out my skin issue. And while I was doing that, I started reading labels of food and I'd seen a couple doctors. They said, you know, it's just what happens when you get older. And I was like, why? I always asked why my whole life. Like, I was like, just super curious. And no one had an answer. for why this was happening. And so finally I said, you know, gosh, like maybe it's something in what I'm eating. And so I started reading labels to try and really track it and determine what was going on. And while I was doing that, still wasn't losing weight, but I started, like, one day I just purely by chance looked down at my diet soda and saw the ingredients in my diet soda, which I had been giving a pass to for like a few months. You know, I knew it was there, but I just didn't really want to look at it. And that's when I realized, like, I didn't know what I was putting into my body. I cared more about what I was putting into my car than what I was putting into my own body.
That's interesting. And I went through a diet Coke phase too. And you know, the gross thing, it had to be in a can. I had this thing, it had to be in the ice cold can.
Yeah. And that's, and I mean, for me, it was like going to Circle K in Arizona where I grew up. I was like, you know, it was like a habit. I'd be like bored and I'm like, I'm going to go up to Circle K.
And would you get the fountain one with the big cup?
Yeah.
Yeah. Those are good too.
And those were really good too. And so, and sometimes I wouldn't even finish them, but I would just like sit there and drink them all day. And then when I was working at AOL, I mean, of course they didn't tell me at the time when I was working there, but you know, later after I finally gave up my Diet Coke, people would say to me, oh my God, I would never go into a meeting unless you had a Diet Coke in front of you. I was like, really? Like, was I really like that bad? And they're like, oh yeah, it was like really, it was really bad. I'm like, why didn't anyone tell me? Like this, I mean, I've been hearing this now for years from like random people. Anyway, so that was, you know, for me really kind of the beginning of this. And then one day, you know, after I'd given up drinking Diet Coke and I started drinking plain water and really feeling like water is so boring, I aspired to be a water drinker, but I started slicing up fruit and throwing it in the water. And I thought, now this could get me to actually be okay with water if like somebody bottled this beverage. So I went searching for this, you know, creation, went to my local Whole Foods that had just opened in San Francisco. And I thought, you know, I'm going to find it here. Well, I didn't find it there. And then I looked all over. I looked on the East Coast too, in New York at some bodegas. I thought somebody's got to put like fruit and water with no preservatives and no sweeteners in it. And no one was doing it. There were carbonated versions of the product. They weren't using real fruit. There was preservatives in them. I didn't want bubbles primarily, not that I had an issue with bubbles, carbonation in my water, but I didn't want it because I thought I want to drink at least, you know, 8 glasses a day. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, you can't, that's really hard to drink 8 glasses of bubbly water. Like you feel like you're going to blow up. So, I mean, that was kind of the beginning of Hint. And, you know, it, from there, I took it into Whole Foods and I didn't even know there was a corporate headquarters in Austin. For me, I went to my local Whole Foods and I started asking the guy stocking the shelves, how do I get it in? And, you know, he thought I was some crazy lady and asked me all kinds of questions like, did you work in the food industry or the beverage industry? Nope, nope, nope. So plenty of doubts in my own mind, but also doubters, right? Like that's just another way of saying this is never going to happen. So he didn't want to waste his time with me. And that was really the beginning where I just said, I'm going to go try this because I think it would be pretty damn cool if I could get a product on the shelf at Whole Foods.
Yeah. Yeah. When did you know that this was going to work? Like so you had the idea, you did, you're obviously a great researcher. You go talk to a lot of people. Once you realize you need to know something I know about you, you'll talk to people, you'll find out, you'll learn, you'll try things. You know, was there a moment that you're like, this is going to work?
You know, I think that I had an inkling when I would like have friends try it. I mean, somebody was asking me this question the other day, like, did I have focus groups? And I said, okay, so my house was right across the street from this private school, a grade school, boys school, and called Town School in San Francisco. And my kids didn't go to school there, but I knew a lot of the parents in the lineup. So I would, like, while I was trying to figure out how much fruit would go into the product for taste, I would be sure to be outside at 8:30 in the morning because I knew they were dropping their kids off. And I, like, literally, like, to this day, those, you know, poor parents, typically mothers, I would make them try the drink, and, you know, and they would say, nah, not really. Like, they didn't even know the name of it. But today it's so funny because they're invested in the brand. Like, they were my original taste testers. Mm. Like, they feel very proud that they were part of it. And so I feel like there were, you know, there was inkling, like, people, no one hated it. Like, people were like, oh no, it needs more, you know, and they were giving me opinions. But when I finally got it on the shelf and consumers started buying it, and people that didn't know me were actually like writing to me saying, oh my gosh, exactly what I was looking for. That confirmation from customers, I mean, obviously buying the product was nice, but also just writing me, like, I had never worked in anything where consumers like actually gave me feedback like that. Like, they like love shopping on AOL through something that I had built, but they didn't say, like, maybe they said overlying, like, oh, it's easiest service, but they didn't say like, oh my God, you've saved my life.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, there was this pull that I was getting from them, like, oh, thank God, you know, I've been waiting for this. I didn't know I was even looking for it, but you've like solved this problem for me. So I think that that was when I was like, there was way too many people early on. And I still get those emails today that people just really, you know, loved it. And that for me was not only when I thought that it was actually going to be a business, but I'll tell you, when times get tough and you can actually have consumer feedback where, you know, people can tell you, oh my gosh, you're doing everything right, or, you know, or give you like feedback on, oh, this isn't right. Like, that is such a powerful thing. I mean, it's sort of the advantage of working and sort of developing something too. Like, I think people, like large companies, it's hard for them to do that, right? And so I think it's the advantage of really starting companies and sort of solving problems and, you know, purpose-driven brands, I guess we call them now. Like, that is really, yeah, like the meat of that conversation where people feel strongly about
it. Let's talk about when, by the way, you know, it just hit me. It probably was so exciting for you to have it after being in like the tech world where everything's so kind of intangible, and especially like to your, you know, your family and stuff. Now you could say, we make this, you know, it's a thing.
100%. In fact, when the bottles were rolling off the line, when we were first doing it, my husband went with me because he was like, oh my God, she just took $50,000 out of our bank account. Like I said, I'm not going to Jamaica with girlfriends. I'm right, like actually making a product. But when that happened, he said the exact same thing. He was like, okay, I get it. Like, it's really exciting. You have a physical product and, you know, yeah, and before you didn't and stuff. And I was like, okay, that's a little bit of it. But the bigger thing is that I feel like if we can get people to enjoy water, then we wouldn't have type 2 diabetes growing at the rate that it's growing. Like, I felt like there was this, you know, health component that no one else was focusing on in the beverage industry. Yeah. And frankly, you know, it's still what we do. I mean, I talk about us as, you know, we're definitely a beverage company to many, but we really are about helping consumers get healthy or stay healthy. And I think especially during COVID, you know, I have seen that topic ramp exponentially for people that, you know, real people are, you know, it's the solve of the hour, right? Like, if you can actually tell people how they can stay healthy, like, you know, people do their best and put masks on and wash your hands and all that stuff important. But I think there's still this like big question, like, you know, if I can actually stay healthy and yeah, do what I can. So I think it's, you know, more important than ever to make sure that you have
totally,
that.
Totally. The book is called Undaunted, and I love that the book is focusing on, you know, and I don't want to say that, I'm trying to figure out how to word this because I know you. And let me just say, like, from the outside, even since the moment I met you and really just was just so in awe of you and how you work and how you've done this, I haven't been aware of the struggles that you had. I knew a little bit about going, you know, some of the fights to get on the store shelves, the run-ins you've had with like the big, you know, beverage companies trying to keep out the little companies. But tell me more about the book, why you wrote it, and maybe some of the stories that we can get a glimpse of.
Yeah. So the book is called Undaunted, Overcoming Doubts and Doubters. And I mean, it really stemmed from my realization that so many people believe that going and starting their own thing or being an entrepreneur is like, you know, sexy and easy. And, you know, and they might not think it's totally easy, but they think that it's for different people, that there's like this DNA that exists for like, they're not like me. And so I would be out speaking at a lot of events and there's always a hand that goes up and, you know, people would say to me, like ask questions, but also often make statements that would be, you know, you're different than me. You don't have fears. I'm sure you never had doubts. And one day I basically responded back by saying, actually, we're not that different. Actually, the difference between you and me is not that I don't have doubts. And it's not that I don't have doubters or fears or I haven't had failures. It's that I go out and try. And I'm not afraid to try. And so that is, you know, I so often see these people who can't get out of the gate because they have these blocks and they have these walls up in front of them. And, you know, it's a mindset, right? Where they're like, oh, I just can't go any further. And what I realized in, you know, so many conversations after that was that if I could actually share the stories that and all of the stuff that I've been through to let people know why I believe what I believe, that you just have to go out and try and you have to get a handle on your own doubts and, you know, squash your doubters and, you know, and definitely I'm a big believer in listening, but it's into your doubters, but to learn, but then you need to still go try and do these things. I felt like if I could tell people how I did it, maybe that would inspire them to go do it as well. So that was really the big thinking, you know, behind the book. And I was writing for 4 years. I was, you know, really talking about lots of different examples, primarily in the building of Hint. Although, you know, I also talk about, I mean, things like my first official job was at a toy store in Old Town Scottsdale when I was 14. And, you know, somebody had told me you have to be 16 to get a job, but there was a, you know, help wanted sign in the window. And I just decided, I'll just go and apply. And they never asked me like how old I was. I mean, it was just kind of, I don't know, it was a pretty casual conversation. And then I got this, you know, job and it was to do the cash register on Sundays. And then I ended up very, very quickly actually helping buy toys for the store because I was 14 and I knew what was going to sell. Mm. And so my boss, the owner of the store, loved that I actually like loved what I did and was passionate about what I did. And so she started asking me to go to toy fairs with her and, you know, and do all kinds of stuff. I was like, okay, that sounds cool. Going to a toy fair at age 14, yeah. Like what's that? And so what was funny is I'd go home and I'd tell my dad like, oh, I got this job and I'm making money. I'm like super happy. And my dad would be like, wait, did they ask you like how old you are? Or I can't believe. And I was like, yeah, I know it's crazy, but I love it. I love what I'm doing. I'm helping her. I don't know. It seems good. I'm learning a ton. Yeah. Like I was learning about, you know, profit and loss and margins at age 14. I mean, things that were just like, again, and I was working in a toy store. I was like the original Tom Hanks and Big, right? Like, I was loving it. And so that's what I look back on some of those stories. And I think, you know, there's a lot of lessons there, not only for people who are in my position, but also, you know, for kids too. I mean, you know, how to, you know, really encourage people to go out and figure stuff out. And then there's also personal stories. I mean, there's one in there in particular that Jamie Dimon, who's kind of been a mentor to me over the years and gave me one of the blurbs for the book, said, you know, he definitely was, it gave him some sort of moments of thinking a little bit, which was a story about the Grand Canyon. And I've always been afraid of, heights. And I decided I don't want to be afraid of heights anymore. So I'm going to go and do the Grand Canyon. And, you know, people who know me really well said, why would you do that if you're afraid of heights? And I'm like, because I don't want to be afraid anymore. Mm-hmm. I don't want to live that way anymore. I've lived that way for a long time and I keep putting up roadblocks in front of me. And so I was very, you know, this is one of the chapters in the book where I, you know, thought I had figured everything out. I had a strategy. I started at 4 o'clock in the morning going down the canyon, you know, when it was dark, so I wouldn't see the bottom of the canyon. And, you know, I had it all figured it out. And I talked to so many people about it. And when we were almost, you know, I won't give away the whole chapter, but, you know, one thing that never, ever came up in any conversations was the 9 miles. It's 22 miles rim to rim. And so I was doing it one day with a group of, I guess, 6 or 7 of us. And the bottom of the canyon, there was no shade in the bottom of the canyon. It was like, and I was like, how could people, like, 9 miles with no shade? We did it in October, but still I was like, it's still hot in Arizona in October. And with no shade, like, I was like, okay, I got a hat, but PS, like, why didn't anyone tell me that there's, like, we've still got miles and miles to go and it's no shade. So, like, I almost had a heat stroke. And then a few other incidents in the canyon, including I ran into a rattlesnake. And what I thought when I actually encountered a rattlesnake was something that, you know, I really want people to take out of the chapter, which is, you know, I remembered a situation when somebody told me when I was growing up in Arizona to always stand back like 15 feet from a rattlesnake because they don't actually slither to you, they jump. And so you have to be careful, you know, just to stand back. And so I remembered that. And then while I was remembering that and standing back, you know, at least 15 feet from the rattlesnake, looking down the canyon, like thinking, oh my God, if I go around the snake, I'm going to like fall off the canyon. I thought to myself, okay, this seems really hard, but like I need to wait it out and I need to wait for this like thing to go by. And by the way, I've been through way harder things in my life, and including like running a company during the 2009 financial crisis. Did those things connect to most people? No. But I thought, this is really hard. This is really challenging. I have to wait. And I'm waiting and I'm watching the rattlesnake, but I'm also like recognizing that I can do this. And so that was the thing that, you know, Jamie Dimon said too, that it's like, you know, so often people are like, you know, separate work from, you know, personal life. And I find that if you love what you do, then it all meshes together. And so many of the lessons and so many of the challenges are actually things that work hand in hand and ultimately make you stronger. But it's also, I think that it's another topic that I really try to convey in this book, that you can't do anything about the past, right? So often people are like, I shouldn't have done that. You know, I should, like, I'm like, accept the past and figure out what lessons are that you've been through and challenges you've been through that help you move forward and do better the next time. Mm-hmm.
So what were the doubts? The subtitle is Overcoming Doubts and Doubters, right?
Well, I mean, just as an example, I mean, starting a beverage company, right? I had no experience. People would ask me when I was, you know, going into Whole Foods and, you know, talking to them about putting it on the shelf, you know, the first question is, well, you're starting a beverage company. Have you worked at, you know, Pepsi or Coke? Nope, I haven't. What other company have you worked at? I worked in tech. So what experience do you have? I am a customer. And they were like, okay,
I drink beverages.
Right. I've now like discounted you all the way down. And, you know, and then, you know, probably the biggest story that I also talk about in the book was, you know, finally, so many doubts in my own head, doubters kind of sharing with me why I shouldn't be able to do this. And then finally, we were trying to figure out like shelf life. You have to, you know, can't just have something that goes bad after a day. So we were trying to play around with that a little bit. And a friend introduced me to somebody at one of the large soda companies in Atlanta and said, oh, you should talk to them and maybe they'll help you scale the company. Well, I reached out and sort of didn't even know that I didn't have plans to say this, but I blurted out, you know, basically, hey, I'm really excited to talk to you. Do you want to buy the company? You can just have the company. I don't even care anymore. Like this stuff is so hard. And somewhere along the way, even though I was sharing that we had been really successful in the Bay Area and gotten it into a bunch of places, he blurted out like, you know, sweetie, Americans love sweet. This thing isn't going anywhere. And I was like, wait, what? What's he talking about? Here I am like telling him how great we've been doing. And then he was like, forget it. This thing is like, you're hallucinating. And so what I realized is that he basically had a different strategy than I did. And he was, to some extent, brainwashed into believing that his strategy about sweet was really the answer and really how consumers were thinking. And like I said in the beginning, that, you know, the thing that I was hearing from consumers, not only for motivation, but also for confirmation, was that they weren't looking for sweet. They were actually looking for a drink that tasted good.
Yeah.
And it didn't necessarily have to be sweet. And so I allowed him to just, you know, keep going and keep talking. And, you know, again, it does take a lot of courage, right, to sort of talk to a very senior level person at a large company in an industry that you're in. But when you can actually realize that they're not necessarily thinking the same way you are, or, you know, my goal was always health. Their goal, never in that conversation did I hear him talk about health. I heard him talk about, you know, like selling you something and tricking you.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? Versus actually, and I looked at my own life and I thought, you know, here I bought into this for many, many years, this like word diet, and it didn't get me where I wanted to be. And I think what's so sad is that, you know, what we've learned, not just about diet sweeteners, but also regular sugar, is like sweet isn't, it's an addiction, right? It's not like something that is, that a lot of people can just say tomorrow, like, I'm not going to have it anymore.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, it actually, I mean, it's scientifically proven that the brain gets, you know, this need for it. And so,
you know, so I just want to jump in. It's so interesting with the sweet. So I've raised my kids pretty much. I mean, we have treats, but I don't keep junk around the house. You know what I mean? And I always wondered when they got old enough to do like Halloween, really, you know, when they come home with the bags of candy, I was like, I wonder what they're going to do. Like, are they going to go nuts and overdose on it? And I think because they don't have that stuff often, they'll have a little of it, and then they'll put the rest away. And that always stuck out to me, because that's not what I did when I was little. like I would first pull out all the Reese's peanut butter cups and eat those like the first night. Those are my favorite. And then I'd go back and eat more. And it just raised my awareness too. Now when they try stuff, they'll say sometimes, oh my gosh, this is too sweet. Like if we're traveling and they end up getting a soda or something.
My kids have said that too. Yeah.
It's fascinating.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, look, it still is my purpose today that I tell people like, look, sweet in moderation is, I don't know, it's probably okay. Right. But I think at the end of the day, I think like the biggest challenge in America and frankly the world is with a lot of these diseases that are out there. And, you know, really the biggest, I mean, today type 2 diabetes, when I started 15 years ago, it was 2% of the population had type 2 diabetes in the US. Today it's 40% has type 2 diabetes or prediabetes. So, you know, it's a problem. And, you know, those lead to heart disease and cholesterol. And, you know, and again, like, I think that the decks are stacked against consumers to try to get healthy. I mean, we have these great stores that, you know, people think, oh, if I just go shop at Whole Foods, I'm great, right? The reality is like, you still have to read labels and you still have to search. And, you know, I think that the dirty little trick in, you know, the soda industry and many of the food industries is that there's, you know, that the consumer was really tied into calorie counting, right? And so how do you get around calorie counting? Well, you just develop a sweetener that doesn't have calories in it. And so that doesn't actually, you know, measure what the brain is really doing when they actually have the sweet. And I mean, that's a whole other podcast. Yeah. What's really disturbing is that there's so much research being done even around these diet sweeteners that gets tied up in, you know, studies that are getting funded by, you know, the large soda companies, right, or the sugar industry. And so, or people who make drugs for type 2 diabetes. And so,
oh my God,
they actually have the ability to release the results of these studies. And of course, they don't. And so the consumer loses in this whole thing. And especially when we're in a situation where we're talking about, you know, healthcare and who pays, like, it actually does matter, right?
Let's talk about the big food and big soda companies. And I'm, and I'm hoping you can be somewhat unfiltered as well as undaunted. Maybe the next book's unfiltered.
Yeah,
you really lay it out there. I know there's some things you can't and maybe wouldn't, or maybe would just wouldn't say on a mainstream media or show, but I know you've had some run-ins with the big soda companies. They truly underestimated you and then tried to keep you off shelves. I know some of them didn't want you speaking on the same panels as they were on. Can you talk about that? See, I see that's the moment when they're like, oh shit, this woman's onto something, or she's speaking the truth. Can you talk about all that?
I think like the thing, you know, that I realized is even at these conferences, right, you think like, oh, we'll put all these beverage people together. And I've never felt like I like necessarily had the same mission, right, as a lot of these soda companies. Of course, I'm a for-profit company, and so I've always wanted to sell lots of product. But for me, this has always been driven by the consumer and wanting to help the consumer get healthy. And so, you know, so often people will just naturally ask me, like, why did you want to start Hint? And I will tell the story around health. And you just see people on these panels that are like in the soda industry shrinking around me. Because first of all, I have a lot of knowledge on this stuff. And I'm not like, you know, talking conspiracy theories or any, you know, like I understand it. And I think that the sad thing is that I actually care about it. And I think that I look at the soda industry and so many of these beverage companies that are out there. And I think that in many ways, they're way worse than the candy industry, because they're, I think most candy today, you know, people recognize that they should have it in moderation. People don't think that about the diet soda industry. I mean, they're starting to understand it and believe it, but it's just not, people just give it a pass for some reason. Mm. I mean, even when people like me that were trying to get healthy, where I was, you know, looking at food labels, I wasn't looking at drinks. And why should I? Because it says the word diet. Somebody's out there like researching this and must be good for me. And so that's the thing that I've, you know, I would say is they have a lot to lose, right? Like, it's like, you know, I think the soda industry in general doesn't really want water. They don't want consumers to drink water, like, because they're making money mm-hmm. off of it. So, you know, it's like, and I think this just goes to, I mean, this is a bigger discussion too. It's like the challenge when you become a public company. I think that there's good people at all of these companies, you know, but I remember Philip Morris way back in the day, like, you know, they weren't, I think they were doing the same thing. When you become a public company, then, you know, you have to make sure that you're answering to shareholders, right? And people that actually want to keep seeing revenue, and they want to see, you know, better margins, and they want to, and the only way to really do that is to grow your company. And so I think that that's the biggest, you know, thing that I've noticed about this industry is that it's, you know, very, very, there's a lot of players in it, but the weight really sits with a few in the soda industry. And I think my belief and what I share with entrepreneurs is like, you'll always have those people, as we've seen, and I talk about in my book, come out with knockoff products and compete against you. And I used to worry about that. Now I, you know, laugh, because what happens is that especially when they have other products in their company that kind of go against the grain of what they're trying to do, because they're trying to, you know, knock me off the, you know, take a chess piece off of the game board. What I've realized is that they'll actually get more space for us in stores, and they'll bring more marketing dollars to the category, and then they'll, you know, figure out something else to do.
Oh yeah. Cause they're increasing the category then. They're increasing.
Right.
Room.
They increase the category. And so I think like the thing that we've really thought about in, you know, another story that I talk about in the book is like when we started really getting a lot of competition, I mean, we saw that we were getting, ultimately they gave up and we would get some more space in the stores, but we really figured out that it kind of went even deeper than that. It was like, how do we ultimately service the customer? I mean, this game of like getting kicked out of stores because one of the big soda companies says, oh, I want their space and I'll pay you millions of dollars. How can we ultimately control our destiny? And so that was really when we went into our direct-to-consumer business. And after being in Amazon for like a year, and we really, we saw with Amazon that this consumer wanted to shop from home and buy online, and that there was, with Amazon Prime, there was definitely the subscription business. That was like, the business was taking off. The challenge for us was that we didn't have the names, so we couldn't communicate with the consumer.
Right. I remember that decision. Do you remember I brought you in to speak to that at a little small workshop when I was just starting to pivot and wanted to have different conversations, and I hand selected and invited in these amazing women, and you were so wonderful to drop by for a while and spend time with us. You had just made that decision. And I remember it was a huge decision because you had to invest then in infrastructure and like shipping capabilities and logistics. And like, I mean, it was huge, then you own the data, then you own the customers. And then that, I'm sure you learned, I mean, since then you've learned a lot about your customers and their habits.
Yeah. I mean, we've not only learned about, you know, really trying to understand the individual, but also when people go from like a beverage to like, could we actually gain the trust of a consumer in beverage and then encourage them to try our sunscreen, right? And move on to, you know, these different products. And so like we just launched a hand sanitizer just last week. And, you know, people are like, oh my gosh, a beverage company now launching hand sanitizer, business must be really bad. And I'm like, not at all. Like I was just getting really annoyed with the fact that I would go and grab some hand sanitizer at like a store that I was going to, and I'd want to put hand sanitizer on, and half the stuff just either has way too much alcohol in it, or
it feels toxic. I don't know. Some of them must be.
Or it's toxic, right?
It just feels that way. It smells horrible, feels horrible. And I'm like, I just almost rather not put it on.
This was sort of the last straw a couple of months ago. I was visiting a girlfriend of mine in San Francisco and went to her building, and there was this big pump of hand sanitizer. It was kind of liquidy. I pumped it out. And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh my God, like this smells so much like tequila. And the guy behind the desk was like, it is tequila. And I'm like, wait, it's in a hand sanitizer. He was like, yeah, but we use tequila. I'm like, wait, what? Like, this is the craziest thing. And it took me like 2 days to get the tequila off my hands because I put so much on my hands. So again, like, I just feel like people, like there's just products out there that are just like, what are people doing? And again, I want a healthy product that, and again, like, you know, yes, we are a beverage company. We definitely sell the most in terms of, you know, the category, but I think for us, having a direct to consumer business has allowed us to really, you know, get to know the customer. And I mean, it's another thing that I talk about in this book that I didn't know whether or not it was going to work. The fact that, you know, we were a beverage company and, you know, talking about the doubts and that, but I tried, and, you know, I tried to launch a hand sanitizer. I tried to launch a sunscreen and a deodorant, and we've done, you know, so far, you know, we've done pretty well in doing that, but I believe in the power of trying.
Mm-hmm. We love the sunscreen, by the way. I just got to give a plug for the sunscreen because, you know, all parents love the spray too, because it's so damn easy, you know, turn around, put your arms up. But they're so toxic, the ones out there. I mean, so bad. And people are spraying their babies with this stuff. I'm like, oh my God. And then you came out with this and I was just so thrilled because it has a little very mild fruit scent, like not too scented. It's perfect. But I have to tell you, I was wondering, I'm like, oh, I wonder if, because you've seen some companies then have a core product and then they start adding on things and it kind of dilutes the power of the brand. You know, did that weigh on you? Were you really like, okay, should we start branching out or was that always the plan?
No, I mean, when sunscreen was the first product outside of the water and we only like named it Hint because I had to get FDA approval because all sunscreens are FDA approved. And so you have to send in paperwork and they needed a company name. And so I was like, okay, well, I'm Hint. I didn't even have like the rights, like the trademarks for sunscreen when I applied, but I figured, oh, yeah, okay, I'll turn it in and see what happens. And then while I was getting approved, I got the rights to it. But anyway, yeah, not at all. And again, like, I think that that is not only my story, but it's the story of, you know, all good entrepreneurs is just, they didn't have all the answers. Nobody gave them, you know, here's what you got to go do. It was, you know, okay, go try this, watch it closely, see if it works, you know, back off if it doesn't. But if it does, like start putting, you know, the pedal to the metal, right? Yeah. And I think like that is the story that hopefully is conveyed in this book to people. And, you know, even, I mean, John Legend is one of our investors and somebody who read the book before it came out too. And I mean, he said, you know, even the music industry, you don't have to have a physical product. You don't have to be a female entrepreneur to appreciate this book. It's a book about, you know, going out and trying and ultimately years later being a company, you know, a few hundred million in sales and, you know, continuing to grow every year. And like in spite of COVID, in spite of, you know, these challenges that have gone on. And I think that at the end of the day, it's like, if you pay attention to the customer and like really watch how they're behaving and how they, you know, whether or not they're sticky to what you're talking about. And I think that this applies to a service, it applies to, you know, a physical product as well. But I think that that's hopefully the message that people will be getting.
Yeah. I can't wait to read the book just to learn more. Like I know a lot of Kara, but I want to get like all Kara, you know, I want all Kara stories, all the Undaunted moments, all the doubting moments. Undaunted comes out. I think we're trying to get this show out. We're pre-recording this 2 weeks ahead, I think, but the book should be out. What's the official launch date?
October 20th, but it's in pre-sale too. Oh, so
they can go now and order.
Yeah.
I love pre-sale. And, yeah. You know, when you think about where things are going from here, like, are you focusing on Hint and branching that out? Are there anything else going on? What do you think is the future for Hint and Kara?
You know, I think for me, it's continuing to service this customer, right? Like I really do believe that, you know, your business grows when you feel like you've got this relationship with the consumer and you're solving problems for them. I think that that is it's just, you know, you think about it. It's really common sense. It's like whether you're looking at a service or a physical product or, you know, and that could be in a product like a water or, you know, I think about Apple and Steve Jobs all the time. Like if nobody wants your product and doesn't think that you're solving a problem, then like you shouldn't be doing it, right? It's really that simple. So I think that that is what I think about all the time. Like as long as I'm continuing to be important for the consumer, like do they need me? I think that that is the most important thing.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Thank you so much. I can't wait to see you soon again in person.
I know, you too.
Let's wrap up with three great pieces of advice for everyone.
So my hope and really, I would say that the three things that are most important to me is knowing that they don't have to have all the information in order to actually go out and try. So maybe there's two things in there, maybe not. And I think more than anything, that having passion for what you do, I think especially in today's day and age, is just so critical, right? Like, it's like, I think there's so many options out there. Like, no longer do you just, should you be going to get a job just for the money? Like, I think you just really have to believe in what you're doing. And I think it really parlays into third, that there's so many ideas out there. Like, how many times have you sat there and said, gosh, I wish there was this? And like, why not actually go and make it happen? Mm-hmm. And I think that the answer really is, and you know, obviously, again, part of what I talk about in my book is that it's not about, you know, having like the right, whatever, schooling or experience. It's really just about like having the passion and having, you know, the sort of wherewithal to actually go and say, I'm going to go on this journey and I'm actually going to go and try. And if nothing else, it will make me a better entrepreneur or a better employee for next time. And I'll, you know, be really proud that I actually went and tried.
Mm, I love it. Thank you, Kara. This has been great. Everyone, you have to go buy a copy of Undaunted. It is, there's a reason that I love being around Kara. I think her courage is contagious. I've learned just so much from being your friend and colleague.
Oh, you too.
Thank you so much for just being here and being so open with everyone as well. Just, you know, you're always very generous with the advice you give and the resources you share. And I'm sure the book is a lot of the same.
Oh, you're so nice. Well, definitely let me know when you buy the book. You can get it on undauntedthebook.com or Amazon. And if you buy, when you buy the book and you read the book, definitely reach out to me on Kara Goldin on pretty much all social channels.
Where are you most lately? Instagram?
You know, I'm on Instagram and Facebook and LinkedIn. I love Twitter.
Really?
Twitter is my jam. Okay. I have like a pretty decent audience on Twitter. It's like, it's kind of fun, you know, you know what I find about Twitter that is really the most interesting is that there are not a lot of leaders that are on Twitter. And so I feel like Twitter is a place, you know, it can definitely be toxic at times. I'm not going to lie, right? And that's when I exit. But I feel like it's a place where, you know, this is another episode again, but I feel like that consumers today buy not just products, they buy from people, right? Like they don't, you know, if you've got a product and a bad leader or somebody that just you can't relate to, then, you know, more than likely you're not going to buy the product if there's another choice, right? Or service or whatever. And so I feel like it's just a place where they can see that I'm a real person and, you know, I have kids and life and, you know, challenges and, you know, smoke in my backyard. And again, like I feel like it's just an interesting place where it's not just about pictures and keeping it up and positive. Like, I feel like it's a very real environment. Mm.
Yeah. So. For such a, you know, detoxified product, you know, that'd be like a toxifying environment.
And it has, like I said, there are moments for sure, but actually I think that the more it's sort of like, how do you build audiences? The more that you actually participate, where I feel like when I have had some really toxic people and there's been moments, actually my community kind of kicks.
That's the best when, you know, cause that'll happen sometimes. And, you know, I tell my team, they'll be like, what do you want to do about this? I'm like, nothing. Watch what happens. And like, my people will come take them down.
It's true. Right. And I think that's so true. And that's what I found there. Like, that's when I knew that I had developed community. Yeah. Right. And like when people are mean, you know, to me that they like, you know, take them down. Yeah. But I mean, I've had issues where like I couldn't figure out, for example, why my sound on my YouTube wasn't working. And it ended up that Apple has this glitch that they can't really even figure out what the deal is. But if you launch like one of the different music, Spotify, and then you launch YouTube, then you won't have any sound on your computer. And it doesn't happen on all the computers, but some of them. So I went out to the Twitter universe and I said, I don't have sound on my YouTube. Does anybody know why? And of course you have the dumbasses who are like, oh, is your volume up? You know, like, right. I'm like, yes, like my volume's up. I get it. Right. Is it plugged in? Right. Oh, thanks. Right. I'm really not dumb. But then, you know, if then other people were like, are you running Spotify at the same time? I'm like, I am. And they're like, did Spotify come on after YouTube? I'm like, I am. And they're like, oh, go into the panel and do this. But anyway, 15 seconds later, fixed. I'm like, whoa.
There are some good people, you know, left on Twitter, right? Apparently. Maybe I'll give Twitter another chance. Maybe I will.
You need
Maybe
to.
Maybe I will.
Come be in my little tribe, okay? Because they're all, I'll introduce you. And I don't know. I feel like there's almost a, sometimes I feel like it's a little bit younger audience than I see like on Facebook, but it's also, and probably more males, but that's not always true either. Mm-hmm. But people who want to learn about things, and a lot of entrepreneurs on there, actually.
All right. We'll see you on Twitter. I'll come over just to say hi at some point, but I'm usually hiding on Instagram.
Come say hi. You're so funny.
Okay. All right, everyone, you got to go buy the book, Undaunted. Kara, thanks for joining us, and we'll talk soon.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Have a good rest of the week. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you for joining me for this episode of Glambition Radio. If you enjoyed the show, make sure you subscribe so you automatically get new shows every week. And I'd love if you left us a review. We are on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, and other platforms. And I'd love to hear from you. Come join the conversation online. You'll mostly find me on Instagram, but also on Facebook, Twitter, and more. Just head to alliebrown.com. You will find them all there. And you can also learn about upcoming opportunities to meet in person. Glambition Radio is the elevated conversation for women leaders, and I'm honored you've tuned in.